Well, good morning and welcome to Woodhaven Baptist Church for our service today. I do have a few additional announcements that will be coming from our prayer sheet, as well as something else. I want to advise everybody of something that took place. Governor Henry McMaster has designated Sunday, May the 3rd as a state day of prayer. It was an honor to be on a teleconference with him earlier this week. And as we were talking with him through the State Baptist Convention, it was a good day, and we want to just advise you that Sunday the 3rd is a state day of prayer. We're going to be praying for all of the families that have lost loved ones to this virus, emergency workers, whether it be healthcare workers, police department, fire, all essential jobs. We want to continue to pray for them as they have just fought through this and continue to be faithful. So I want to let everybody know we need to be praying for them. And as we do that today, just continue to lift them up as we move forward and begin to transition back to whatever is normal. I don't know what normal is anymore. And the new normal is not going to be the same as the old normal. But we do want to continue to lift them up, as well as all of our leaders, whether it be on the local, state, and national levels. We need to be lifting them up in prayer as well, because there is a tremendous weight of pressure making decisions that will affect all of us. So remember to keep them in prayer as well. I also want to kick off today. Today, it being the 1st of May, these are going to be our new pew Bibles that are going in the pews, and I am going to ask a really big favor. We're going to be dedicating them after Father's Day, so we've got all of May and part of June that we're going to be doing this, but we're going to ask if you would like to place a memorial or in honor of to help pay for the pew Bibles. The pew Bibles are $10, and if you want to place a pew Bible in honor or memory of, send that into the church. But here's the trick. Don't do it through e-giving. Send a check in separate with your name and who you want to either put it in memorial or memory of or in honor of. And we'll be placing these in the pews after Father's Day. But we're going to continue this from Mother's Day, kicking off before Mother's Day today, as well as through Father's Day. But here's the trick, guys. We only, believe it or not, we only had to do 100. And I hope we have those 100 took care of really quick. So if you want to do this, do it quickly so we know who they are and we can go ahead and get the labels, the book plates. I learned that this week. There's a such thing as a book plate, not a book label. You do book label and Google that, you're going to come up with all kinds of stuff. But we're going to be doing these, and I wanted to get that out there. But we will be taking that through Father's Day. And I also want to ask everyone to just continue to lift up those that are on our prayer list. That email will be coming out. You'll get that. And so be lifting up. We've got several members that are really in some rough shape right now. We want to lift up our chairman of the deacons, Calvin Montgomery, as well as Ken Falkenberry, who's struggling with some things right now. And also we had a death in our church family, per se, with Mr. Bill Cranford. We want to remember the Cranford family as they transition and have to go through this time with the loss of a loved one. So let us pray this morning. Father, we love you, and we just thank you for the day that you've given us, Lord. And we just ask that you, as we pray for the state prayer, Lord, as the governor has asked, that we remember all of those in the emergency preparedness and emergency services, as well as local, state, and national leadership, the families of the healthcare workers, the families of those that have lost loved ones during this time. Lord, we just ask specifically that you be with them as we lift them up in prayers today. And Lord, we just love you. We want to give thanks for the prayer and the love that, or for the love that you show us each and every day. And as we show the world, the church is not a building, but it is the people. Lord, and I just pray that people keep that in mind. It's not about the building. It's about the people. And we are the church have been deployed into the world. So I pray that we be faithful in sharing the message that is often shared within the walls, and we share outside. For we love you, and we praise you, and we lift these things to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, guys. Thank you.
Praises and singing praises to you this morning. Lord, what a glorious day it has already been, and I look forward to continuing this service this morning and see what your word would have to tell us today. And Lord, I'm just so thankful for those that are here to be able to put this service together and what each and every one of them mean to this church family. Lord, as we, again, try just to get back to a sense of normalcy, Lord, I just pray that we would seek your leadership and guidance in how we do this and when we do this. It's going to be a timing thing, but Lord, as the service and as your message this morning is, we're going to wait on you. We're going to wait on you to tell us when and what and how. And Lord, I just pray that we be obedient unto that and just not worry about what the world says, but we want to be a good steward and just be about your business and in your timing. For Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we lift these things to you in the sweet, precious, and holy name of Jesus. Amen. Well, as we transition this morning, I want to go ahead and introduce our specialist. I don't know if he's a specialist or not, but he's special. As he comes forward this morning and sings our special in music, something that we've been missing a little bit. So we're getting back in, one stage at a time, getting back to normal. So Jamie Falkenberry is going to come this morning and give our special, and just pray for him as he sings.
Oh, my soul.
Thank you, Jamie. That's words of wisdom right there in that song. You are not alone. God is with us in these times. It didn't catch him by surprise. He knows what's going on, and he is there with us in the midst of our trials and tribulations, controversy, sickness, whatever you want to call this. God is there, and he's in the midst of everything. Before I get started this morning, I want to say a great big thank you for the shock that took place this morning as we got here and prepared for to take the service, and all of a sudden somebody's going, y'all gotta go out front. I said, for what? I'm thinking, okay, they're gonna take a picture. I like taking pictures. Little did I know, as we walked out, all of a sudden, there's a lot of cars down the street from the church, and they're coming by, and they're honking and waving, and there's a parade. And it meant a lot to Dr. Tom, myself, and Alec. See, get to me. It meant a lot. And we want to say thank you. There's a lot of people that it takes to do this. It's not just Tom and Alan and myself. There, as you saw, the people singing have to be here to give up their time and talent. And others that are behind the scenes, you don't see. Derek up at top running sound and making sure everybody sounds good. I don't know about looks good, but we sound good. And then Matt with doing the camera and taking care of all that. And just people here behind the scenes, not that we're congregating. You got to be careful how I say that. We're not having a group or anything, but there are several people that are involved in putting a service together that you never see. And I want to say thank you to all of them as well. And so now I think we see that, again, the church is not in the building. We saw that this morning, and it was great. It was really great. So there'll be some pictures to come from that, and you know, just continue to lift up the church leadership as we transition and start making decisions on when we can get back together, how we're going to get back together, the ministries that we can continue, and so on and so forth. But just we're going to wait on the Lord, and that's what this morning's message is all about. I want to go ahead and give you the verses. So if you have a copy of God's Word, we're going to go ahead and I'll tell you where to go with that. Look in Psalm 27, verse 14. And that's where I'll be reading the main text from this morning. And so it will go from there. And the title this morning is just simply this: wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Why should we wait on the Lord? Because usually when we get ahead of him, we wind up lost. We wind up in trouble. We wind up on the wrong path when we get ahead of him, because our minds can't fathom what he has in store for us and for the guidance and leadership and things like that. You know, when we tend to take off on our own accord and our own agenda, let's just be honest, we mess it up. We'll mess it up in a skinny minute because he has great plans. We may have good plans, but he has great plans for what he has in store for us, even through what we're facing right now with this pandemic of the coronavirus. COVID, whatever you want to call it, it don't make no difference. It's just this bug, this sickness, this pestilence, whatever you want to call it. But we're going to wait on the Lord. And I want to give you some topics this morning in reference to that waiting, but I want to read this scripture this morning. Again, we're being Psalm 27, verse 14. The scripture reads like this. It says, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Now see, it's important enough that we do that because the psalmist wrote it twice in the same little piece of scripture. Wait on the Lord. So there's got to be something to this. And in looking at this and reading and doing a little bit of study, I find out why. You know, I do. I find out why we need to do that. The first point of that is, why wait on the Lord? Well, wait means a lot of things. The word wait, W-A-I-T, wait, means slow down. Get a different perspective. Just wait. Don't do nothing. No, it don't actually mean don't do nothing. There's still something that we need to be doing while we wait. But while we wait, there's some things that are important and that we don't get ahead of the Lord. And how we do that, what's one of the most important things that we can do while we wait? That is pray. One of the most important things that we can do while we wait, wait means pray. Stop. Pray. Right there. 2 Chronicles 7, 12 through 14 is a great piece of scripture that gives us the incense on, or insight on that. It says, the Lord appeared to Solomon. And we're talking about as Solomon was going through everything that he was going through. It says, then the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I have heard your prayer. I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up heaven and there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people. And then here's a verse we've been hearing a lot of right here. This part of this, we've been hearing this a lot lately. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. See, we've been hearing that part, that verse, you know, verse 14 of that. My people are called by my name. But see, we got to pray. We've got to pray. Even in our repentance, we do that through prayer. So while we are waiting on the Lord, we need to pray. We don't know what God has in store for this land. But I'm telling you something. This is from the book of Kenny right here. I truly believe that God has given the world, not just our land or our little, you know, our little plot on the map right now. But I truly believe that God has given the world an altar call. And is calling the world back to them, calling his people to him, calling those that may not know him to him through prayer. Because everything that's going on, we're seeing government go crazy. We're seeing people go crazy. They're getting impatient. They're getting ahead of the government, wanting to open things and take care. Listen, and if governors such as Governor McMaster are waiting on the Lord and they're praying, they're waiting on his advice on what to do next. They're not wanting to get so far ahead and get too quickly, because we can get in trouble if we do it too quickly, because we're going to turn around and put us right back where we were. And the rise in the cases of this sickness will go up. But we have got to pray, and we need to do this. We need to pray in a sense of quietness and meditation, waiting on God's answer, and be quiet before God so we can commune with him. And listen, and not just lift up a wish list to God saying, okay, God, here's what I need today, and then run on about my way. No, we need to wait. And in waiting, God will reply to us in our time of waiting. He'll answer our prayers. But we've got to be patient and wait on him. You know, I read a little example of a, it's kind of funny, and I can relate to this, you know, being quiet, communing with God. It reminds me of a story I heard about a little girl that walked into her daddy's study, and he was in there working, and everything was kind of quiet, and he looked up and kind of dropped his glasses down on his nose to see what his daughter was wanting, and she just comes in, she says, I don't want anything. I just wanted to be near you and be quiet. That's what it means to be in prayer with God. To be in meditation, in connection with God in our prayer. And while we wait on him, we need to be in that meditation. We need to be in that sense of quietness. We need to be still for just a moment and wait on God. But also, if you look, Ephesians 6 verse 18 gives us even a little more insight on that. It says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance. Did you hear that word? Perseverance. We've got to persevere. And supplication for all the saints. See, it's not only about what we want. It's about what's best for all. We got to persevere so that it is best for all, not just for some. Because there are groups out right now, man, they're banging the doors down to get businesses back open, get back to certain jobs. And I understand. I'm not saying this, that it's not a way of lifestyle. It's not a lifestyle that we've become accustomed to, because people are losing their jobs. and financial stress and strain is coming on people, you know, and mental stress. But we've got to look, pray always. We got to pray. Pray always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. And when you get in the Spirit, you know, it's much more easier to understand and be in tune and just be in touch with God when you're still and quiet in your prayer time. You know, there's people that pray much more eloquently than I do, that's for sure, because I kind of stumble through mine sometimes. But you know, God's not worried about the words that are coming out of my mouth, but the words that are coming out of my heart. And in doing so, when I'm still and I'm quiet, the true me comes out of my heart. And so that's where we are right there. So to wait means to pray. Second part of that is this. Wait also means to work. Now you say, well, now wait a minute. You just said be still. Yes, I did. Be still in our prayer. But see, wait means to work. What do you mean wait means to work? That wait, you go or you don't go? What is it? What? Make up your mind there, preacher. Well, you know, we can wait and still work. Because we got to wait to get back to normal, but we can also wait and continue sharing the love of Jesus Christ through however we can. You know, we can wait and talk on the phone and pray with or for somebody. We can wait and just send an email, send a text, reach out, yell at your neighbor across the street. But we can work. And we are to work as well as wait, not just to sit on our hands and tremble. Oh, Lord, what do we do now? No, 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 no. God didn't give us that spirit. But we can work. You know, believe it or not, there are things that have happened, even though we are not in a sense of normal, there are things that have took place right here within this church building over the last several weeks. There's been work that's took place. And there's going to be some shock and awe and surprise, and I'm just tickled to death on some of the things that have took place during this time, as we've been still, but we've still been working. And we should follow the advice of a couple of verses right here. If you look at Galatians 5:13, it tells us, "For you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only do not use the liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another." And we can serve one another during this time, during this period of waiting to see what God's got in store. And it's so odd. We've been called to liberty. Now here's where we got to be careful. In that call to liberty, you know, we tend to be free, you know, but what happens when we get too free? We get crazy. We do things out of order. We tend to miss or skip the instructions of life that God's given us in His manual here. And so we've been called into that liberty, but we don't need to use it as an opportunity for the flesh. And that's where we need to be careful right now, as we get back to things opening up and you have that liberty. When they lift this ban or they lift the restrictions and the guidelines, we still can't just rush in. We have got to do it in an orderly fashion and wait on God to tell us, okay, this is what you need to do next. Because, and I read this example as well, the leadership in this church has been called to shepherd. And a shepherd has a sense of protection for the flock. I have a big responsibility. Alan has a big responsibility. Dr. Tom has the ultimate responsibility. Because no matter what Alan does or what I do or any other leader, ultimately it's going to be Dr. Tom. As the senior pastor in this church, he is the ultimate shepherd here that's going to find ultimate responsibility or liability. But we want to be careful, because the shepherd has to protect the flock from many different ways. One of those is this virus. One of them is being very careful and not giving in to demands that we get back too quick, because we don't want to see none of our people sick. But we have to be very careful. And 1 Peter 4:10 tells us, though, and this just kind of puts that all in perspective, as each one of us has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. See, we got to do it in grace. And we got to minister. And so when we wait, we can still work. We can wait and pray. And we can wait and work. And, you know, Robert Norwood said this, there is no use saying our prayers unless our prayers mean guidance from God in service. Did you catch that? We can pray, but we need to be praying and seeking the guidance of God in what we're praying for. You know? So let me kind of head up things here just a little bit. We've been out of sort a little bit this morning. I'm still excited about that parade. I'm telling you, I want to jump and joy because I saw people for the first time in over like 6 weeks. My precious folks that I hadn't been able to wrap my arms around and love on them. I've been calling people. Hey, how y'all doing? Do you need something? Can I do something? You know, even if it meant going and get something and drop it off on the doorsteps or something, and still being able to work while we're waiting on God. But we just have to learn to sit still for a minute and be patient. And as we move forward this morning, there's a third thing that what we have to do while we wait. And this is going to sound a little crazy. It's going to be like an oxymoron or just a, well, double negative, or however the English term is for this. I'm not real sure, but wait means wait, period. Wait means to wait. We don't want to hurry God. We can't hurry Him because we like I told you earlier, we tend to get ahead of ourselves so much, you know, and it reminds me. I have a grandson that's a little over two. And when he gets in a hurry, that big little head of his gets ahead of him. And the next thing you know, as with any child, when they first learn to run and go on, I get so tickled watching him. What happens when that head gets ahead and we don't wait? He's down on him, hands and knees. But no, graciously or gratefully. And thank you, Lord, that he is resilient, can just pop right back up. You know, he's up running again, wiping it off, brush his knees off, you know. But when his mind gets too far ahead of his little body and he starts running and he's going to fall. Well, we're the same way. When our minds get too far ahead of us, we stumble and we fall. So wait means to wait. We do not want to hurry God. We don't want to be impatient with Him. Because if we look back in biblical times, we'll see what happens when folks get ahead of God. Failure is imminent when you get ahead of God. And I'm just being honest with you. There's troubles and tribulation. You know, we can look at this. Romans 12:12 tells us that we should be rejoicing in hope. Get this now. Patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer. Wait means wait. Being still. Waiting on God. You know, and one of the biggest examples of that is, you know, I see a lot of times, and you see this in churches' lives, where all of a sudden you get an influx of people, and then the next thing you know, the murmur starts through the church, well, we need to build a new building. We need to build and get bigger. And all they see is building, but they're not waiting on God. See? They get ahead of God, and all of a sudden, they'll build this great big building, fine building, and all of a sudden, there ain't no people to even put in the building. People are gone. And now they have a budget that they can't pay for because they got ahead of God. And I've seen it happen in personal lives as well, not just church lives. Anybody out there ever made a big financial decision and not wait on God to give you an answer whether or not you're supposed to do it? Anybody ever bought a car they weren't supposed to buy? Yeah, buddy, I've heard a few stories about that. Didn't work out real good, did it? But we got to wait on God, you know, and even, not just necessarily in the big financial purchases, okay? Waiting on God means to wait, even in the little things and guidance. You know, asking God, well, Lord, is this the right school I need to attend? Asking about college. Big decision for some that are coming up, especially at this time of the year when we should be celebrating graduation really soon. We may not be able to do that just yet. We're still waiting. But waiting on an answer from God to help you decide where you need to go in life. Do I need to make a transition in my life and make a job change? Do I need to accept this? And when you ask, wait. Be still and wait. You know, one of the verses that really sticks in my head about waiting, though, is because we spent 2.5 years going through the book of James on Sunday night Bible study. But one of the verses that sticks in my head is James 2 through 4. In chapter 1. James chapter 1, verse 2 through 4. It says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Did you catch that? Being patient brings about a good work, a perfect work, completing what we need. We won't be lacking anything. We'll be in the will of God. We'll be right in tune with Him. And we'll be in His time. And in His, because patience, man, I'm not telling you, look here, folks. We have all learned a very valuable lesson in that James Bible study. I'm not praying for patience, okay? Because in order for me to have patience, I got to have the trial and the tribulation and the hardships. Because that's what brings about. But here's the thing. We got to rejoice. And when we rejoice, what are we doing? We're lifting praises to God. Even in the bad times, ladies and gentlemen, even in the times in which we face today, we need to be rejoicing with God. Listen, there are people all over the world that are in a lot worse shape than where we're at right now. I spoke with a pastor just the other day who was in touch with a worker in another part of the world. Men are allowed out 2 hours a day. Women are allowed in the house 2 hours a day, and it alternates. If you are caught outside of your home within those two-hour time spans, you will go to jail. So you think we've got it bad? We just need to be patient and wait on God so that we are lacking for nothing. You know, again, let's look back in our original text in the book of Psalms. It says, wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and He shall strengthen your heart. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. So I pray today as we close and get done, Lord, that we just take our time, which is what we're doing here, getting reset, trying to get back to the new normal, because the old normal is not going to be here anymore, that we, while we wait, pray. While we wait, keep working. Keep doing the little things that you're doing to make the world know that Jesus is real, and that we're not alone. Just as Jamie sang earlier, let them know that we're not alone. He's here with us. But also, wait means wait. We gotta wait. Don't get ahead. You know, I've seen a lot of, I don't know what I want to call that, but it's just not very good stuff that has been put out on social media about how bad the decisions are that governments make, and how bad, and it doesn't matter what decision they make, they're wrong. They're either wrong from me, my perspective, or they're wrong from your perspective, but we've got to wait, ladies and gentlemen, or else this thing's going to spike again, so be patient. And know we love you, And we're going to get there. It's just going to take a little time. So we need to be patient. And as we are patient, we'll have some perseverance and we'll be able to get through this once again. So God bless you this morning. I'll be sending out an email regarding the new Pew Bibles and how to do that, how to send the monies in, what to do on that. Again, because we want to honor those that we would like to in placing the new Pew Bibles. And just kind of brighten up our sanctuary a little bit. This will run through, Father, from Mother's Day to Father's Day. Or until we just get them all done. All 100 of them. My prayer is we get them done before Father's Day. So maybe if we get them all done before Father's Day, we'll place them in the pews and dedicate them that day. Or dedicate them that day and then have them placed in the pews the following week. So, and if we're waiting on the Lord and He's got it in His will, who knows? We may be back in the building. I don't know. I don't know yet. Don't call me and ask me, because I don't know. But we're working on it, and I want you to be patient with that. So God bless you today. Check us out on all of our social media aspects, whether it be the website, Facebook, YouTube. Continue to hit share and like so that the videos will continue as you watch the service and it picks up more and more. You just never know, because I'm seeing some posts and things from people I don't even know. So there are people are sharing. See, that's part of that work. That's part of that work. Just by sharing your church family. See, that's what we're sharing our church family with the world today. And we look forward to having our pastor back up here and sharing a message. I don't know that he'll become a televangelist or not. He may wait till we get back live. But just continue to lift him and his family up as we go through this. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you next week.